session, we have someone who loves keep his mouth moving.
Whether he's constantly talking
or trying out different cuisines.
He's a team leader in sales and operation.
But man, he sure knows a lot about construction.
He's big.
He's strong.
He loves to play ball. Here's Chris Krasta.
So, good evening, brothers and sisters. Good evening. I'm so happy. I'm so excited, you know, to be talking to all of you all today. So, you know what? Without any further delay, let's just begin. So, yesterday, we heard what Jared spoke about, right? So, I would like to begin with the analogy that Jared began with. Jared said that I'm not a very big football fan, but I'm just going to say what Jared said, okay? So, Jared spoke about how Liverpool was supposed to beat Barcelona by 4 goals if they wanted to reach the finals, yes? So, Jared said that how nobody expected Liverpool to beat Barcelona, but in the end, we saw that Liverpool beat Barcelona, right? And it was like a goal, like a vision that Liverpool had. And finally, they're victorious, right? So Jared said that is something similar with our community also, right? God has given us a vision, a goal that we are to accomplish, right? And that vision is nothing but making our families empowered by the Holy Spirit and giving Christ to other young people. But, you know, the question is it enough to only have this vision? Like going back to Jared's example, if Liverpool, was supposed to beat Barcelona by 4 goals and the match was after like almost 1 week, right? So in this 1 week, what do you think Liverpool did? Did they just like sit and sleep, I don't know, drink Pepsi, eat cutlet pav? No, right? That's not what they did. They practiced, they worked hard, they strategized, and then they went to play the game. And that's how they won the game, right? So that's the same thing even with the vision that God has given us, okay? It's not like we're just going to sit and accomplish that vision. We got to work towards it. We got to do something from our end that vision is accomplished in our communities. So that is what we are going to speak about today as to how we are called to accomplish that vision that God has given us. Cool? So, that's what we're going to speak about. So, we will go back to what Dalrine spoke about, yes? So, Dalrine spoke about how we are called to build the foundation of our lives on the rock, yeah? And that rock is none other than Jesus Christ. So, I know yesterday Jared went to a construction site, but, if you have gone to a construction site where they have just like began the construction, you will see that there is a foundation that is laid. And on this foundation, right, there are building blocks, yes? And on these building blocks, the whole building is built. So, the same way, God is telling us today to strengthen these building blocks, which is a part of the whole foundation. Cool? And that is how we are to accomplish the vision that God has given us. So, what are these building blocks of our life? These building blocks of our lives are nothing but our relationships. Cool? So, we will speak about 3 specific building blocks or relationships in our lives and how can we strengthen them. Cool? So, the first relationship is our relationship with God. So, Dalrine spoke about how to build our lives on this foundation, we really need a deep relationship with Christ. Yes? That's what she spoke about. And then, she also went on to say that, bigger the building or higher the building, deeper is the foundation, right? So, the same way to accomplish that vision, right? It is very important for me and for you to really be in a deep and intimate relationship with God. And for that matter, that is what we always hear about, like right from our intake camp. We hear about how important it is to be in a relationship with God, how we are called to be in a relationship with God. Yes? So, I liked what Anna spoke about yesterday, when Jared was interviewing her, if that's what he was doing, okay? Anna said how she would, frequent the sacraments and how the sacraments would give her the grace to be united with God. And when she said that, it reminded me of last year's conference, the Gospel of John, chapter 15, verse 5. Where last year, God called us to abide in Him, right? God called us to be united with Him. And we also learned last year that as we abide with God, as we are united with God, we bear fruit. Yes? Now, the question is, what fruit do we bear? In simple words, you know, in some sense, the fruit that we bear is also like the vision that we accomplish. Because as we are united with God, as we abide with God, when we bear the fruit, we bear the fruit of giving Christ to other young people. We bear the fruit of making up families empowered by the Holy Spirit. So, brothers and sisters, I think this is the point where we really need to question ourselves. How is my relationship with God? Do I do my prayers on a daily basis? Do I do my scripture reading? Do I avail the sacraments? And so I leave you with this question. And if you think that, you know what, I am struggling with my relationship with God, it's okay. Today is a day, maybe we go back and speak to our GD heads and come back to God. Simple as that. Cool? Okay, so let's go to the next one. That is our relationship with our families. The second one. I know we are all at home. We are locked down and for 6 or 7 months, we are only in the house and it's difficult, I understand. And since we are at home, there could be times when we are irritated with our parents. There could be times when they have hurt us and we have hold that anger within our hearts. Or maybe we are just not spending time with them. Like we have online classes going on. So maybe I'm in my room the whole day and I just come for breakfast, lunch and dinner. Okay, that's possible. But, you know, today God is calling us. God is calling us to strengthen this building block of our lives. God is calling us to take a look at our families today. And that is when I'm reminded about what Anna spoke about yesterday. You know, she said how in the evenings, she would spend time with her family. She would speak to her parents, her siblings. I don't think she said siblings. I'm not sure about that. But also she spoke about how during her prayer time, they would pray together as a family. They would have dinner together. And this is what she would do to spend time with her family, right? And how she would protect this time, because this time was only for her family. So I think today we need to ask ourselves, how much time do I spend with my family? So, you know, I remember like 2 years back, we had something called as the Advent Challenge in Mangalore. Some few challenges in the season of Advent, okay? And one of the challenges that we were supposed to do was, I do something very simple, not to take our phones on a dining table. Simple. And that's what I also did. And I realized after some point that we started having good conversations at home instead of just like being on the screen the whole time. And from that time onwards, I make it a point every day. It could be during breakfast, if I can't, during lunch or dinner, whenever it is, to spend some time with my mom, with my dad and with my sister. So if we are not doing this, maybe today is the day we could actually start doing that. Yes. The second thing that I want to talk about here is, you know, like I'm giving you a session right now. I'm sure that in our areas, we are giving Christ to others in some way or the other, maybe through music ministry, maybe by giving sharings, testimonies or whatever. But when it comes to our families, right, what I've realized is we think twice before giving Christ to them, or we go everywhere to give Christ, but at our own families, it's a big no. So maybe that is something else we could question ourselves. Cool. Okay, so now comes to we spoke about two things, spending time with our families and giving Christ to them. Yes. So the two other practical things which we could do to strengthen our family is, the first one is pray for our families. Like I know, okay, we do our personal prayers, we do our Bible readings, we fasted for the RYC, but many a times we sort of like forget to pray for our own family members is what I feel. So maybe that is something that we could start from today onwards. And the last one is just helping our parents, you know, serving them in whatever way possible. It could be maybe helping them sweep the house, swap the house, or if they ask us to do something, we just do it. So whatever way we can is serving our parents. Cool? So we spoke about four things, spending time with our family. We spoke about how, you know, we need to give Christ to them. We spoke about praying for them. And then we spoke about serving them. So, I would like to leave you with this question. How does my relationship and your relationship look like with your families? Cool? Okay. So, let's go to the third point. So, we spoke about our relationship with God. we spoke about our relationship with family, and now we are going to speak about our relationship in the community. So, as a community, if you really see, we are called to be like one family, right? And that's what we are told in MFC or Missionaries Families for Christ Youth, right? And we are called to be united, having a common goal, right? That's what a community is. But if you really look at ourselves, I think we need to question ourselves, are we really united as one? Yes, we do our sharings. We have one-to-ones, we have an accountability, which should actually bring us together, which should help us grow in a deeper relationship with God, and which should also help us accomplish our vision, right? But is it really happening in my community? Is it really happening that, we are united as one? So whenever I speak about community, right, I remember about the book of Acts, okay, the book of Acts chapter 2, the disciples are really scared and Pentecost happens, the Holy Spirit comes on them and they go out and start preaching, right? So what you read throughout the books of Acts is, as they go out and preach the good news, they go to different places, okay? And what they would do is, they would go to a place, they would preach the gospel and they would build a community there. They would go to somewhere else and build a community at different places. And we read it in scripture that these communities, right, that they built just started growing, man. And that's what we are also called to do. The apostles knew that the communities that they built there were built on the foundation of Christ. So let us ask us today, let us ask ourselves, is our area, wherever you are from, Bangalore, Mangalore, Pune, sorry, I can't take all the names, okay? But wherever you are from, ask ourselves, is my community built on Christ? And is my community showing the values and virtues that Christ showed? So, brothers and sisters, what we spoke about till now is how different relationships in our lives are like the building blocks on the foundation, right? On the foundation being Christ. And we spoke about our relationship with God, our relationship with family, and our relationship with the community. Cool? So, can I see a thumbs up? Okay, great. So, what we'll do now is, we'll just go back to what Dahlgren spoke about, right? Dahlgren said that a house built on rock is going to stand firm, but a house built on sand is going to collapse when there's a storm or a rain. Yes? So, the same way, our relationships too, built on rock, are going to be long-lasting relationships. But our relationships built on sand are going to be relationships which are not going to help us in furthering the mission that God has given us. Cool? So, what we'll see right now is, what does it mean to build our relationships on sand? So, SAND is an acronym, okay, wherein S stands for selfishness, A stands for anger, N stands for negative speech, and D for disobedience. So, we'll take each one of them and see how they affect our relationships. Cool? Can I see a thumbs up? Okay, great. So, we'll go for the first one, that is selfishness. So, selfishness, in very simple words, is basically thinking only about myself. It could be in the community or in the family. I'm not going to think about my brothers and sisters, but it's all about me. But we need to remember, we always need to keep the mission in our mind, the vision that God has given us to accomplish. And you know, I see that even while we serve in the community, it can so happen that even while I serve, I may only think about myself and not really realize that there is a greater picture. There is a bigger picture that God has called us to accomplish, right? So, what we'll do right now is, brothers and sisters, we'll just take a look at a small skit and see how we may be thinking only about ourselves.
Hey, Annabelle.
Hey, Kimberly. I'm just calling to remind you the meeting is at 4 p.m. I'll see you there.
Annabelle, I think I'll come by 4:35.
Is there any reason for the delay? It's best if you log in on time so as not to keep the others waiting.
Okay, I'll see.
So, I realize there are two very important things in this skit. The first one is that Kimberly is a very good actor. Okay, she was good. So, the second one is, what did we see in that skit? Okay, the GD head is calling, you know what, come for the meeting, it's 4 o'clock. But Kimberly is like, you know what, I'm just going to come at 4:30, you know, my time, my wish. And that is what something that happens in our communities also, right? Even I used to do that is what I'm trying to tell you. So it can so happen that we can only think about ourselves so much that we may not really think about the other. And it can happen in so many ways. One we just saw is about the time, okay, coming on time and not really thinking about somebody else. Or it could be simple sacrifices, man. Like, we need to ask ourselves, you know, am I ready to make the small sacrifices for the sake of the other? So I think today we just need to ask ourselves this much is, am I a person who only thinks about myself? Or am I a person who also thinks about my brothers and sisters? And I leave you with this. Think that in our community, is we only think about ourselves and not about our brothers and sisters. Do you think, or do we think that our community will really accomplish that vision that God has called us for when we only think about ourselves? That is something that I think we all need to ponder upon today. So now we go to the second one. So we spoke about selfishness. Now we come to A. A being anger. So brothers and sisters, when I spoke to you about the community, right, our relationship in the community, what I said was, in a community, we are called to be united. And as we are united, we accomplish the mission that God has given us. Yes? So what anger does is, it basically breaks this unity in our community. And it's quite obvious, right? When we are not united in the community, definitely it affects our communities to really accomplish that vision. So again, we have a skit, okay?
Hey, Annabelle, do you know anyone who could help me with an activity for Sunday's meeting?
Why don't you ask Nick for help?
Nick? Are you okay? Nick broke up with my best friend Sasha. I'm not talking to him ever.
So, we saw the skit just now, and as always, Kimberly was good, okay? Good in the sense her acting was good, right? So, when I saw that skit, right, two things came to my mind. The first thing is, two things that we do in the community. The first is choosing sides, okay? And the second is harboring anger. What I realized is, even when I look at myself sometimes, it's so easy to keep anger, to keep unforgiveness in our hearts, right? But today we need to ask ourselves, or rather we need to tell ourselves, you know, we need to let go of that. Maybe we need to choose to forgive, and we need to choose to see the greater picture. We need to see that God has asked us to accomplish that vision. And to accomplish that vision, we are called to forgive. We are called to be united as one. To give you another example, you know, let's say, the same example, two people don't really like each other, they're angry at each other, and the two of them are serving at the same intake camp, okay? So, do you really think both of them will give their best? I don't think so, right? And that is how, in small ways, that our anger, our frustration, our irritation against our brothers and sisters can cause a big hindrance in accomplishing the vision that God has given us, okay? So, maybe I would like to end again by asking you a question. You can ask yourself, or maybe even I can ask myself at this moment, do I hold grudge against my brothers and sisters? Am I angry, or do I hold anger very easily against my brothers and sisters? Or am I a person who's able to let go, who's able to forgive for the furthering of our mission? Okay, cool. So let's go to the next one. We spoke about selfishness, spoke about anger. Now let's speak about negative speech. So negative speech is something that's really common in our community. We may do it on purpose, or maybe we may not realize it. But when it comes to gossip, backbiting, you know, speaking about somebody, or using foul language, all of this comes under negative speech. So let's just see how negative speech is a part of our lives, maybe in the community or somewhere else. So again, skit people, over to you.
Rishin, you know Jack?
Yeah.
Frankly telling you, I think he's a hypocrite. Don't be fooled by his behavior during meetings. I know he leads prayers and, you know, acts all holy. But I've heard that in college, he's always flirting around with the girls.
Lindorf, it's not nice to talk about someone like that.
Are Shane, chill, yeah. It's not like I'm saying it to him.
So, what did we see in the skit? You know, what I really liked about the skit is the last part. He says, "Arey chill, yeah. You know, it's not like I'm saying in front of him, okay? And this is something that we always do, right? Like, it's only between us, man. And somehow, the only between us reaches to another 46 people, right? But again, it comes down to one question, a simple question, okay? Does my speech, okay, in any way or to anybody, lift up my brothers and sisters? or does my speech put them down? Okay, there have been times, even when I asked myself, am I gossiping about somebody? Or even for that matter, when I, something that I would do a lot is make fun of somebody, and without realizing, I would make fun by putting that person down. And, a couple of years back, I realized that there are so many people who were hurt because of my speech, by the way I would think it's fun, but rather I would just keep putting that person down. So again, it comes to that. Am I lifting my brother or my sister, or am I putting them down? And finally, something that I think needs to be addressed is our sharings. We know in our community, we are called to share our lives with each other. But there have been times, okay, where our trust is broken. And this is something which is very serious, and I think we all need to look into this, how when we share about, or somebody shares something about us, we need to keep that trust. And if that trust is broken, then it really, really causes a big hindrance in our mission, brothers and sisters. So let us ask ourselves, again, I know I've said this like two times, but I'm going to tell you the third time. Is my speech lifting up my brothers and sisters, or am I putting them down? Great. So let's go to the last one. Okay. That is disobedience. So when we talk about obedience, we first talk about our obedience to God. It so happens in today's world is we choose what to obey. You know what? I like this about the church, so I'm going to choose this. I like this, so I'm going to choose this. We think it's like a buffet. Wow, donuts? Yes. Brinjal? No. Okay. So that's how we look at it, right? And, there is a word for Catholics who are like this. It's called cafeteria Catholics. We pick and choose what we want and we leave the rest. So when we talk about our obedience, half obedience is disobedience. We need to keep our trust and faith completely in the scriptures and in the teachings of the church and obey them completely. Okay? And the second part comes, our obedience to our parents and our obedience to our formators. And for this, we have a small skit. Okay? Over to the best actors.
Yeah, hi Tito.
Hello, Dolph.
Tell me. Yeah.
Just reminding you to make the changes in your talk for this Sunday.
Yeah, sure, Tito, yeah. Fine. Tito doesn't know what he's saying. I won't make those changes. What can you do about it after the talk is over?
Man, I relate to this kid so much. It feels like they have taken my example. So, when it comes to obedience to our formators, I remember there were so many times when my formators would ask me to do something. And there are times I would say yes, okay, but I would be really grumbling about it. I would be angry and I would do it with zero joy. So, we need to ask ourselves the same question today. When it comes to obedience, it could be obedience to God, it could be obedience to our parents, or it could be obedience in our communities also. Am I obedient, or do I just grumble about it and I'm irritated about it? Okay, so let us ask ourselves this and let us see what God is calling us to do when it comes to the whole idea of obedience. Cool? So we spoke about sand, right? Wherein S stands for selfishness, A stands for anger, N stands for negative speech, and D for disobedience. We also spoke about how when we base our relationship on these four aspects, they hinder our, they don't allow us to accomplish the vision that God has given us. Okay. So, now we'll go to the second part, which is the important part. That is, how do we base our relationships on the rock? And how, when we base our relationships on rock, are we able to, say yes to what God is calling us to do? So, again, rock is an acronym, wherein R stands for righteousness. Okay, a big word. But what does righteousness mean? Again, in simple words, righteousness is having a right and good relationship with God. Simple. Having a right and good relationship with God. It means choosing not to sin, and constantly seeking to do the will of God. You know, brothers and sisters, if you look at the world today, okay, the world feeds us things which are bang opposite to what the scripture tells us, right? And we can easily get influenced by it. Unless we are really deeply rooted, you know, in Christ. That is, if our foundation is on Christ and if we are in a deep and intimate relationship with God. So, you know, if I ask you, like, what is the definition of sin? And if I ask you right now, like, think about it, like, for like 5 seconds, what do you think sin is? I'm sure there'll be many answers. Sin is going against the commandments. Sin is Satan injected nature. Sin is going away from God and so many other things, right? But according to me, a very good understanding of what sin is breaking the very heart of God. Sin is, you know, telling God that, Lord, you know, I know you want me to do this, but I'm going to do this. That's what sin is. And so what happens is when we are in a deep and intimate relationship with God, what we tell ourselves is, I have a God who loves me, and therefore I don't want to break this heart of God. And I'm going to do my best to not sin again because I love my God. And I am going to do His will. I am going to do what He wants me to do in my life also because I love God. And when we look at this on the whole aspect of love, that we choose love over sin, then things become much more clearer. So the first R is about our relationship with God. So having a good and right relationship with God. Cool? Okay, so don't forget to nod your heads when I say cool, okay? Yeah. So let's go to the second one. That is O. O stands for obedience. So when it comes to obedience, we talk about our obedience to God and our obedience to our parents and formators. So obedience, in very simple words, is simply saying yes to Jesus. Okay. Or in other words, obedience is saying yes to love and saying yes to the teachings of the church. Okay. So now let's come to the second part, that is our obedience to our parents and formators. Something that we need to know is, whenever we are obedient to our parents, whenever we are obedient to our formators, it is like we are obedient to God Himself, okay? Because God has placed them above us. And you know, I understand, okay, there could be times when it's difficult to obey, but that is what we are called to do, right? To accomplish this vision, to look at the greater picture, we are called to be obedient even while we are not feeling like it. So there were times, even for me, as I shared some time back, would be when my formators, you know, I didn't want to do something, and that is exactly what I got to do. Okay, and I had to do it. Yes, there would be times I would do it half-heartedly, but man, we need to work on this area of our lives, that is being obedient to our elders in general. Because even if you look at the commandments, right? So we have the commandment wherein we are called to respect and obey our parents. And that's the only commandment which is associated to our promise, to a promise. And we see the importance of obedience there itself. So the next thing that I want to talk about obedience is just one point, is that somebody told me this very recently, that when we talk about obedience, okay, we also talk about humility. The humility to accept the fact that, you know what, yes, my elders, my formators, my parents, God has placed them above me, and I am going to be obedient to them. Because at this point, I might not be at an age wherein I may understand everything. Okay. So this is the humility that we need to have to be obedient to them. So brothers and sisters, I think we need to ask ourselves at this point, am I obedient to my elders in the community, or am I obedient to my parents? And if it's a yes, great. Okay. But if it's something that we need to work on, then maybe it's time today that we actually start being obedient irrespective of what we feel. Cool. So as I said, the third aspect is cross-bearing. So what do we mean by cross-bearing? I know it's a big word, but in very simple words, cross-bearing is exactly opposite to selfishness. In selfishness, it's all about myself, right? And I don't think about my brothers and sisters. But whereas when it comes to cross-bearing, I first think about my brothers and sisters and do what is best for the others. Okay. So when it comes to cross-bearing, what we do is we can look at cross-bearing in our families, and we can look at cross-bearing in our community. So what I'll do is I would like to explain this with a couple of examples. Okay. So let's take an example for cross-bearing in our families. Let's say in our families, one of our elder has really hurt us. But what we do is we still love them. We still respect them. And we still be obedient to them because that is what God has called us to do. Yes. So another example would be, let's say in our communities, okay, in our community, there is somebody who's really hurt us. Okay. But I am going to serve. I am going to work together. I am going to forgive that person. And we are bearing that small cross, even though that the person has hurt us, I'm still going to work with that person. Cool. I would like to give you two more examples when it comes to the community itself. Okay. The next example is, let's say some of us are group heads here, okay? And we call our members, we do all we can, we do our best, but you know what, they just don't turn up, man. And this is something that even I have experienced, but we don't give up, okay? We don't feel extremely bad about it and say, you know what, I just can't do it anymore. I'm still going to bear this cross and still I'm going to do what I need to do because God is calling us to do that. And a final example that I want to give is something that we probably all go through, okay? We know that our meetings are on a Sunday, okay? And generally in Mangalore, at least it's at 3 o'clock. I don't know what the other areas, I don't know your timings, but generally if it's in the afternoon maybe, or whatever time it is, okay? Maybe it's all about sacrificing our sleep. It could be as simple as that. Yes, I am sleepy, but you know what? I am going to be faithful to my meetings and I am going to attend my meetings because God is calling me to do that. It's as simple as that. And so this is what cross-bearing is, brothers and sisters. Bearing a small crosses in whatever small way we can for furthering our mission, for what God has called us to do. So I think at this point, we need to ask ourselves, what are those crosses in my life which I'm called to bear? And can I bear them with joy? Cool. So now to the last one, that is K. Okay. K for kindness. So when we talk about kindness, okay, we basically talk about this one word, which means many things. Like, for example, kindness could be generosity, patience, being slow to anger, being affectionate, being loyal, and so on. And whenever we spoke about these words, the person who should come to our mind is none other than Jesus, right? Because he manifested these fruits in his life. So kindness is basically being like Jesus to our brothers and sisters. Simple as that. It could simply mean things like, you know, being there for my brothers and sisters in need, or helping them when they need us, or even otherwise for that matter. Okay. So the second thing that I want to explain when it comes to kindness is, we need to be kind, not just when we, when we feel that we want to serve, when we feel that I want to help, or when I feel that I want to be there. Even when I don't feel like it, I'm still going to be there for my brothers and sisters. Even when I don't feel like it, I'm still going to help them. Okay. So that is the first part. So the second aspect of kindness is also directly related to the fruits of the Holy Spirit. Right? And that's what we learned last year, that how when we abide with God, we bear these fruits, the fruit of patience, the fruit of generosity, the fruit of joy, and so on. Like, for example, there could be times in our communities when it's difficult to be patient with somebody, but you know what? I'm still going to be patient with that person. Or maybe there could be times when, about generosity. Like, for example, being generous when it comes to our service. Even when I don't feel like it, I'm still going to serve. Okay. So this is something that we need to consciously practice. And as we practice kindness in our lives, this becomes a part of who we are. Cool. So brothers and sisters, this is what rock means. Okay. And I would like to come to a conclusion right now. And as I conclude, okay, we spoke about a lot of things, I know that, but I would like to conclude with two very simple questions. The first one is my life built on rock? And the second one is, am I showing or am I manifesting these values, these virtues that we just spoke about in our different relationships in our lives? Let us really ponder over these two questions and accomplish the vision that God has given us. Thank you and God bless you all.